Tree will consider issuing the number 8 gale or storm signal before dawn. A one-day operational pause for the U.S. Navy for the second collision in 2 months involving its ships. And the first coast-to-coast solar eclipse in the United States in almost a century. Good evening. The strong wind signal number 3 is still in force. The observatory will consider raising the number 8 gale or storm signal before 6 a.m. tomorrow as Typhoon Hato edges closer to Hong Kong. Elmi Long has the latest.
Calm before the storm. As usual, Chim Sai Cho was packed tonight even as Typhoon Hato edges closer to town. But some tourists are already thinking ahead.
Well, my sister wanted to go to the beach, so I guess that's not happening.
Others may have to adjust their travel plans, particularly those who booked flights with Cathay Pacific or Hong Kong Airlines. Both local carriers are cancelling most of their inbound and outbound flights tomorrow. The MTR is also suspending a number of intercity through trains scheduled for tomorrow morning between Hong Kong and the mainland.
According to the present forecast track, Hato is expected to be closest to Hong Kong tomorrow morning, within 100 kilometers south of the territory, therefore posing a considerable threat to Hong Kong.
The observatory also warned of high tides and flooding. Businesses in low-lying Lei Yu Mun seem to have it under control. This restaurant taped up its glass windows just in case, while the shop had sandbags by the gate to prevent water gushing in. Their precautionary measures will be put to the test in an hour's time when Typhoon Hato moves closer to the city. Long TVB News.
Meanwhile, the city sweltered under record temperatures today, with the mercury hitting a high of 36.6 degrees Celsius at the Hong Kong Observatory. The observatory says it hasn't been that hot since records began in 1885. Henry Sim has that story.
The mercury soared past 38 degrees Celsius in parts of Kowloon and the New Territories this afternoon. A temperature of 38 degrees was recorded in areas including Ta Kwu Ling, Sha Tin, Cheung Kwan O, Sham Shui Po, and Wong Tai Sin. While it was a sweltering 39 degrees at Yuen Long Wetland Park.
After temperatures over most parts of the New Territories rose to 37 degrees or even above. And the Hong Kong Observatory even registered a record high of 36.6 degrees. And this is a record high. This record began in 1885, and that's more than 130 years.
The approaching storm was also behind today's bad air. The Environmental Protection Department said many air quality monitoring stations showed higher than normal pollution levels, with the Air Quality Health Index reaching 8 or above, corresponding to the very high health risk category. The reason for those high readings? Because light winds can't disperse the air pollutants. But we can expect an improvement once the storm moves to the South China coast, as it will bring heavy showers with it. Anne Sim, TVB News.
In local news, activist Joshua Wong was back at court today for contempt of court related to the 2014 Occupy movement. This case involves 19 other activists. Here's Elmi Long on what lawyers said in their final submissions at court.
Joshua Wong returned to the dock 5 days after he was given 6 months in jail for unlawful assembly, this time for a separate case related to the Occupy movement in 2014. The student leader, together with League of Social Democrats Vice Chairman Raphael Wong, are among 20 protesters charged with contempt of court. They allegedly disobeyed
of their mode of employment. Employees with disabilities can opt for assessment and receive wages according to the productivity assessed. For details, please call 2717.
Leave and deliberately obstructed the clearance operation. They questioned if their motive was to attract publicity. Defense lawyers asked the court to assess evidence in its totality. For example, one of the respondents, Chiu Chi Sheng, was moving towards the Tsim Sha Tsui direction as instructed by police, but was arrested with 10 meters left to the road's end. So was it a case that defendants wanted to leave but couldn't, or whether merely being in Mong Kok could be construed as obstruction.
Share your views on or before April 30th.
Bingo.
我是法團通告，通知你嚟緊要請新嘅清潔同保安公司，仲要做外牆維修。你係業主，要俾咁多？哦，你唔知咧，因為你冇出席法團會議咯。
Building owners are responsible for managing the common parts of a building. Owners should attend meetings of the owners' corporation and vote on major issues in person to safeguard their own interests. Active participation in building management benefits all.
My city moves at a fast pace. But when there's a traffic jam,
as another aid signal is issued and remains in force tomorrow morning.
我哋會繼續勇敢無懼，維護法紀。八達哥，你俾人見你成咁，你壓糧都保唔到你咯。我同好多打工仔一樣，每日都搏到盡。退休。
Meilama.
The MPF Default Invest Strategy, or DIS, has been launched. Key features are automatic reduction of investment risk according to MPF scheme members' age, fee caps, and globally diversified investment. If you've never given a big fuss and pronounced the death of the rule of law in Hong Kong, Peter Blue, TVB News.
Turning overseas now, the commander of the U.S. Pacific Fleet says a number of bodies have been found on USS John McKay. 10 sailors were missing when the destroyer collided with an oil tanker early on Monday in waters near Singapore. The second major collision involving a U.S. warship in 2 months saw a gaping hole in the ship's hull and flooded several adjacent compartments. 5 other sailors were injured. Search and rescue operation is continuing. The U.S. Navy's top commander ordered a one-day operational pause to allow time to identify any immediate steps that need to be taken to ensure safety. A broader review will look at the 7th Fleet's performance. There was no immediate explanation. Well, after an extensive review, U.S. President Donald Trump has recommitted America to the 16-year-old war in Afghanistan. In a reversal from his past calls for a speedy exit, Trump laid out the new Afghanistan strategy and declared the military must fight to win what so far has been an unwinnable war. James Aiken reports.
Trump used a primetime television address from a military base to unveil a stepped-up military campaign against Taliban insurgents, gained ground against U.S.-backed Afghan government forces.
From now on, victory will have a clear definition. Attacking our enemies, obliterating ISIS, crushing Al-Qaeda, preventing the Taliban from taking over Afghanistan and stopping mass terror attacks against America before they emerge.
Trump offered few specifics but promised the U.S. would shift away from a time-based approach to a more regional strategy by linking Washington's assistance to results and cooperation from the Afghan government, Pakistan, and others.
Ultimately, it is up to the people of Afghanistan to take ownership of their future, to govern their society, and to achieve an everlasting peace. We are not nation-building again. We are killing terrorists.
Trump also vowed to get tough on Pakistan, accusing it of offering safe haven for militant groups.
That prompted the Afghan ambassador to the U.S. to rate the speech a 10 out of 10. But analysts present isolating Islamabad as the only culprit would increase the influence of regional players like Russia, China, and even Iran.
This is not only the Pakistan, they have to be looked at the role of the regional forces in Afghanistan. So this is a bit more complex situation is going on in Afghanistan. Comparing the simplistic view is adopted by the U.S. Current administration.
In Beijing, the foreign ministry praised Pakistan, a long-time China ally, its efforts in fighting militants and said the international community should recognize this. The Pentagon has recommended sending nearly 4,000 new troops, supplementing the total of 8,400 in Afghanistan now. The Taliban condemned Trump's announcement and vowed to make Afghanistan the 21st century graveyard for the American Empire. James Aiken, TVB News.
The four remaining suspects in a terror cell accused of carrying out last week's attacks in and around Barcelona appeared in court today. Yesterday, the last fugitive from the cell was shot dead near Barcelona after he flashed what turned out to be a fake explosives belt at two troopers who confronted him.
Four alleged members of a terror cell accused of killing 15 people in last week's attacks in Barcelona, the nearby town Cambrils, appeared in court today. The four were arrested for their alleged involvement in the planning or execution of the atrocities last Thursday. Today, they testified before a national court judge in Madrid. The hearing in the Spanish capital comes a day after the last missing member of the cell was gunned down by police near Barcelona.
Just before 5 o'clock in the afternoon, the Catalan police has shot dead Yunus Abu Yaqub, driver of the van and direct perpetrator of the attack in Barcelona on Thursday.
The lone fugitive was shot to death on Monday after he flashed what turned out to be a fake explosives belt at two troopers who confronted him in a vineyard not far from the city. Police said they had scientific evidence that Abu Yaqub drove the van that plowed into crowds on Barcelona Ramblas Boulevard, killing 13 people, and then hijacked a car, fatally stabbed its driver while making his getaway. After 4 days on the run, Abu Yaqub was spotted outside a train station west of Barcelona on Monday afternoon. According to police, two officers found him hiding in a nearby vineyard and asked for his ID. Police said the 22-year-old Moroccan was shot to death when he opened his shirt to reveal what looked like explosives. A bomb disposal robot was dispatched to examine him before police determined the explosives belt wasn't real. A bag full of knives was also found with his body. Abu Yaqub's brother and friend made up the rest of the 12-man extremist cell, along with an imam, who was one of the two people killed in what police said was a botched bomb-making operation.
In sports, swimming sensation Siobhan Howe became Hong Kong's first gold medalist at the World University Games in Taipei. 19-year-old beat a pair rushing to a medal earlier tonight to win the women's 100-meter. Millions of Americans gazed in wonder at the extraordinary sight of a total solar eclipse. One that raced across the country from Oregon to South Carolina. It was the first coast-to-coast solar eclipse to span the North American continent in 99 years.
Unless you're a centurion, this is most certainly a once-in-a-lifetime event for the rest of us. After weeks of anticipation, millions of onlookers from the northwest U.S. state of Oregon to the southeastern state of South Carolina gazed in wonder as the moon reduced the sun to a silvery ring of light. It took 90 minutes for the shadow of the moon to travel across the 4,200-kilometer long by 113-kilometer wide zone, transforming the narrow band of the country from day to night for 2 minutes at a time. Some 12 million people live in the path of totality, where the total eclipse will appear, with millions more traveling to spots along the route to bask in its fully dark glory. The last time a coast-to-coast total solar eclipse happened in the U.S. was back in June 1918, when the world was a much different place. World War I was still raging on, and the Treaty of Versailles that would end the Great Conflict was still more than a year away from being signed.
But war was probably the furthest thing from this couple's agenda, as they signed their nuptials for a totally unique wedding.
You may kiss your bride.
These lovebirds showed that you don't need to outdo your friends with bigger and more lavish banquets to have a memorable wedding. This young lady in Chicago had the birthday gift of a lifetime.
I don't think many people get to say that they had a total eclipse on their birthday, so I think I feel pretty special because of it.
Tens of thousands of feet up in the air, these lucky passengers on a commercial flight got to witness the eclipse closer than any of us earthbound humans. Even US President Donald Trump took a break from his tweeting duties to catch a glimpse of the rare cosmic event with his family at the southern facade of the White House. But he briefly looked up without protective glasses, which drew a friendly reminder. Not everybody enjoyed the event, though. At this zoo in Nashville, Tennessee, flamingos flapped their wings in panic, while giraffes ran amok as the eclipse met their daily routines. By all accounts, it was the most observed and most photographed eclipse in history, including those watching on television and online. Jeff Tang, TVB News.
A reminder that the strong wind signal number 3 remains in force, and the observatory will consider raising the number 8 gale or storm signal before 6 a.m. It's expected to bring heavy showers and thunderstorms during the day with temperatures of up to 30 degrees. And that's all the news for now. Thanks for watching TVB and have a very good night.